This is a quick demonstration of the celiac trunk and the structures in the extrahepatic portal triad, except the splenic artery, which we cannot see because it's hidden under the pancreas. So, where my instrument is pointing, this is the origin of the celiac trunk from the abdominal aorta as an unpaired visceral branch. It originates at the level of T12. The celiac trunk is very small and quite often it is absent also. And immediately as it comes out from the abdominal aorta, it divides into three branches. The largest is the splenic artery, which we can just see the beginning, but we cannot see the rest because it is behind the pancreas. We shall show that in a separate dissection. The next largest is the one which I have picked up here. This is the common hepatic artery. The common hepatic artery runs to the right and it makes a curve up almost 90 degrees. At the point where it's making a curve up, the common hepatic artery gives a very big and an important branch, and this is that branch which you can see. This is the gastroduodenal artery, and then it curves up, and after that it is known as the hepatic artery proper. And from the hepatic artery proper, it gives rise to a branch, the opening of which we can see here because we had to cut it, and that is the right gastric artery. And this is the stomach which we have reflected, and this is the other cut end of the right gastric artery. So this is the right gastric artery. This right gastric artery runs on the lesser curvature of the stomach from right to left. So this is the next branch, the hepatic artery. The third and the smallest branch is this one, which I have lifted up here. This is the left gastric artery. The left gastric artery, again, it runs in the lesser curvature of the stomach from left to right, and this is the other cut end of the left gastric artery here. This left gastric artery, which is running in the lesser curvature of the stomach, and the right gastric artery, which runs on the from the opposite side, they anastomose, they run in the layers of the lesser omentum or the hepatogastric, the gastrohepatic ligament, and they anastomose in the lesser curvature. So this is the lesser curvature of the stomach, which we have dissected open. We have removed the lesser omentum and we can see the left gastric artery and the right gastric artery. Incidentally, we can also see some of the branches of the vagus, more specifically the posterior vagus, which supplies the lesser curvature of the stomach. So this is the distribution of the gastric arteries. Now let's see what happens to this gastroduodenal artery, which I mentioned. The gastroduodenal artery runs behind the first part of the duodenum, and the first part of the duodenum is here. This is the first part of the duodenum where my instrument is located. And as it runs behind the first part of the duodenum, it comes to the other surface. And here, I'm turning the stomach over to show the continuation of the gastroduodenal artery. And we can see this is the gastroduodenal artery. It is now running behind the first part of the duodenum. When it reaches the opposite side, it divides into two principal branches. One of them is this one. This is the right gastroepiploic or the right gastromental artery, which runs on the greater curvature of the stomach from right to left. And the other branch is this one, which I have lifted up here. This is the superior pancreaticoduodenal. This is the anterior, this is the posterior superior pancreaticoduodenal. The pancreaticoduodenal runs in the pancreaticoduodenal junction from above downwards, and it anastomoses with the inferior pancreaticoduodenal, which I showed in another dissection. This is the inferior pancreaticoduodenal, which is coming from the superior mesentery. And they supply the head of the pancreas, the uncinate process of the pancreas, and the C loop of the duodenum. So this is the distribution of the gastroduodenal artery. Let's continue with the gastroepiploic artery, which is running in the greater curvature of the stomach from right to left. This gastroepiploic or the gastromental artery runs between the layers of the greater omentum, and it gives gastric branches to the stomach, and it gives omental branches to the greater omentum. And it anastomoses with this artery that we see here. This is the left gastroepiploic artery, which is a branch of the splenic artery. And this runs from the left to right, and this also runs in the layers of the greater omentum, and it anastomoses with the right gastroepiploic artery. These branches that we see, these are the vasa previa, which are branches of the splenic artery. They run in the gastrosplenic ligament. Now, let me show you the structures which are located in the hepatoduodenal ligament. My finger has gone into this space here. This is the epiploic foramen or the foramen of Winslow. In front of my finger, these three structures are enclosed in a fold of peritoneum, which is known as the hepatoduodenal ligament, which actually is the right free margin of the lesser omentum. And contained within the hepatoduodenal ligament, we have the following three structures. Right, on the right side and in front, this is the structure which I have lifted up here. This is the common bile duct. Front and to the left is this structure which I have picked up here. This is the hepatic artery proper. And we can see the opening of the right gastric artery here. And behind is this structure which I am pointing. This is the portal vein. So duct, artery, vein. These three are enclosed in the hepatoduodenal ligament and they constitute what is known as the extrahepatic portal triad. And they all are entering into the porta hepatis of the liver. So this is about the extrahepatic portal triad. My finger is in the epiploic foramen, and when I push my finger further deep inside, my finger has entered the space which is known as the omental bursa or the lesser sac. Here we can do an important clinical maneuver when we are operating in the gallbladder or anywhere in this region, and if the bleeding starts from the hepatic artery, we can put one finger, my index finger, behind into the epiploic foramen and my thumb in front like this, and I can compress the hepatic artery the way I am doing right now. And by so doing, I stop the bleeding from the hepatic artery. And this procedure is called Hogarth-Pringle maneuver. And it is a surgical maneuver which is done in clinical practice, in surgical practice. Let me mention a few other things about this particular patient. As we can see, the liver is highly cirrhotic. This is a patient who had chronic alcoholism, and he's got alcoholic micronodular cirrhosis or Lennox cirrhosis. And we notice that accompanying the left gastric artery, which I mentioned, is this dilated engorged vein. And in this case, it is thrombosed. This is the left gastric vein. It is so big because this patient had portal hypertension. And we can see that this is the opening of the esophagus, and it is also forming esophageal varices. We know this because this left gastric artery, we can see it is giving a branch to the esophagus. So therefore, the abdominal part of the esophagus receives a branch from the left gastric artery, and it also gives a tributary, the left gastric vein, for this is an important site of portal systemic anastomosis. And this is a proof of that portal systemic anastomosis in the form of an esophageal varices. In this particular patient, we notice yet one more thing. This structure, which I have turned around, this is the falciform ligament. And in the free margin of the falciform ligament is running this. This is the round ligament of the liver. It was enclosed in a fold of peritoneum. We have dissected it out. And we can see this. This is the dilated para-umbilical vein. In case of cirrhosis, the dilated para-umbilical vein will communicate with the superficial veins of the umbilicus and produce what is known as scapulomedusa. Because the para-umbilical vein communicates with the left branch of the portal vein in the liver, and it communicates with the superficial veins of the umbilicus in the abdominal wall. So this is another manifestation of portal hypertension. Another site of portal systemic anastomosis in places of portal hypertension is the bare area of the colon where there is portal systemic anastomosis. The colon on either side has been removed. And the fourth place of portal systemic anastomosis is between the superior rectal vein, which is a portal circulation, anastomosing with the middle and inferior rectal vein, which are part of the systemic circulation, and they can produce internal hemorrhoids. So these are the four sites of portal systemic communication in a patient with cirrhosis with portal hypertension, and these are the sites, these are the manifestations of portal hypertension. To be remembered that hemorrhoids can also occur independent of cirrhosis with portal hypertension. They can be idiopathic hemorrhoids, which are more common. The celiac artery can also be visualized by means of the procedure known as celiac axis angiogram. We cannulate the femoral artery, go through the abdominal aorta, cannulate the celiac artery, and we inject the radiopaque contrast and take images to see the left gastric artery, the hepatic artery, and the splenic artery. This is a still shot of a selective celiac axis angiogram to show its branches. Likewise, the portal vein can be demonstrated by means of an portal venogram, MR portal venogram, and we can see the distribution of the portal vein and its forming tributaries, namely the splenic vein and the supinomocentric vein. And this is another image to show a magnetic resonance portal venogram. So that is all for now. If there are any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. Have a nice day.
And please don't forget to subscribe.